Do you want results next time you go trout fishing? Get yourself a set of trigger spoons and put a limit on the stringer. They flat out produce.
The trigger spoon. Fish on. Button's on the side, baby. On the trigger spoon. Let's see what we got. Something back there dragging on. We got fish on the trigger spoon.
Howdy folks, Kel Kellogg here. Well, that video you saw at the beginning, that comes courtesy of Steve and Lenore Anderson and their kids. They were recently out at Lake Comanche and they were putting a whooping on the trout on orange trigger spoons, just like that one there. Looks like Lenore had her hands full landing several fish, and Steve, he was on the camera. So good for them. I'm glad you guys are enjoying the fishing. I'm glad you're using my trigger spoons, and I'm glad you're catching fish on them. The reviews on the trigger spoons are coming back now. Guys are catching a lot of trout on these. The biggest trout so far is about 6.5 pounds that I've heard of. Lots of pan-sized fish, lots of limits. So anyway, these are very well received around Northern and Central California, but I didn't want to talk about trigger spoons today. I want to talk about spoon rigging, and I don't care if you're rigging a trigger spoon, a trigger spoon junior, a needlefish, a Castmaster, a cripple lure, or a crocodile, whatever it is, I rig them all the same. I thought I'd go over that, but before I get into the actual rigging here, I wanted to say that, you know, about 80% of the time, I run my spoons naked. Guys always ask me, do you run them with a dodger? Yeah, sometimes I do, but about 80% of the time, I'm just trying to imitate a stray minnow, you know, going through the water column. The trout, you know, they're so aware of their surroundings. They can dial in on that, you know, the impulses, the flash, the vibration of that spoon. They think it's a minnow, they grab it, and it's fish on. The exception to that is when I'm fishing big open water like Shasta, Don Pedro, maybe Folsom, and I'm fishing fairly deep. In that situation, I almost always team my spoon, if I'm gonna team it with a dodger, with a 6-inch blade. We'll get into dodger and spoon combos in just a second, but let me show you my basic rigging for spoon trolling. I actually got one of my lead core rods here, and it's set up for spoon trolling. I was actually using this rig last time I went fishing out at Rollins Reservoir. I was using a speed spoon that day and caught several fish on it. So let's start out with the leader to spoon connection. And before I show you that, let me tell you, I tie my leaders in advance. Right now I'm using 12-pound Yozuri top knot fluorocarbon. Fluorocarbon is critical sometimes, so I use it all the time. It reflects water at the same, or it reflects light at the same rate as water, and that means it's virtually invisible to fish. Because it's virtually invisible, that allows me to upsize. I like to use 10 or 12 pound test. I like that insurance. I like that cushion because I'm always trying to catch, you know, really big trout. I don't always catch really big trout, but when I get a big trout on, I want the extra insurance of using a little bit heavier than standard line. You know, most guys are using 4 to 8 pound test on their leaders. Well, I'm using 10 to 12, and it just gives me that much more insurance, and it doesn't cost me any strikes as long as I'm using the proper connection and I'm using fluorocarbon. So let's talk about the connection. Now, you could connect your spoons, you could put a split ring on the nose of them. You could connect them via a loop knot, but the most efficient, easiest way to connect them is to tip your leader with a small light wire cross lock snap, just like that one there. Not a snap swivel, a cross lock snap. You can change lures very quickly, very efficiently with that type of connection. And remember, you want to save time. You want maximum amount of time with your lure in the water. Seconds add up to minutes, Minutes add up to hours over the course of a season, and the more time you spend with lures in the water, the better your chances of hooking big fish. So, I like to use the crosslock snap. I like to pre-tie these because I like to make sure the knots are perfect. I use a Pellamar knot. I typically sit at the bar in my kitchen. I watch some TV. I tie up maybe a dozen leaders. I wrap them on foam pool floaties. I just keep them in my tackle box. And that way when I need a leader, I've got one. If a leader gets frayed or broken, I just grab a new one. I'm ready to go. Again, maximum efficiency on the water equals more time with your lures in the water, and that equals more fish. So, enough said on that. This one's actually a little long, but I typically make my leaders 48 inches long, so I put the snap at the business end up top. I just use a surgeon's loop, just a kind of a double line over, do a double granny knot, draw it down. I make it fairly big, just so I can see it. I'm old and blind. And then my connection to the rod, this is important. This is the line. Thought I was hooked on my shoe there for a second. This is the line coming from my rod. I put it through a bead. Everybody always asks me, what's the bead for? Two things. To some extent, if there's weeds in the water, the weeds will collect right there and they won't slide down and foul the lure. But really what that's for is during low light conditions, it allows me to see that connection very easily so I don't roll this, or I don't reel this trolling snap into the eye of the rod. One, you don't want to damage the eye of the rod, and you certainly don't want to reel that in there if you got a big fish on it and then have him take off and have it bind up in there, and you know, basically defeats the drag on your reel and your line's gonna snap. So that's what that bead is for. It just kind of collects some weeds, but mostly it's just a visual indicator of where that snap and trolling swivel is. This is a multiple joint P-line trolling swivel, and they don't come with the cross lock on them. I've got kind of a medium sized cross lock snap on the end of that swivel, and that's it. I snap my leader in right there. It's important whenever you're out trolling to use a trolling swivel. If you have to speed up and the spoon starts spinning for a second, or maybe you hook a stick or something like that, the spoon, you know, it starts spinning, or maybe you catch a fish and he just kind of starts spinning a little bit. You don't want that twist transferred to your main line, and that trolling swivel helps to prevent that. Now, if you're using something like a rolling bait or something, you know, like a Brad's bait, something like that, I would double down. I might use two of those, or I might use a trolling rudder, but that's a whole different subject. We're talking about spoons. So that is my basic rig 80%+ of the time. Main line goes through a bead to a trolling swivel, 48 inch leader tipped with a cross lock, tipped with the spoon of your choice. Now, if I do want to use a dodger, a lot of guys, they'll put their spoon, gotta turn these around here, I got one of my fisheye 6-inch dodgers here, they'll put their spoon real close to the dodger. I don't like to do that. If you're kokanee fishing or you're fishing a bait that has no action, yeah, put it close to the dodger so the dodger imparts action on the bait. But in this case, we've got a wobbling spoon. We don't need the dodger to impart action to the lure. We want the dodger to put out flash and vibration mimicking a feeding fish. Other fish come in to see what that fish is feeding on. They see the spoon and say, oh, there's a stray minnow, fish on. So I like to space these out. Minimum distance, about 24 inches. I like to go 36 to 40 inches when I'm running a 6-inch dodger like this between my dodger and my spoon. Space that out. Have the dodger working over here. Have that spoon working back here. You're gonna draw the fish in. They're gonna see that spoon. They're gonna grab it. You're gonna be smiling. You're gonna be filling the smoker or the frying pan with trout. It's all good. So those are really the two ways that I rig spoons when I'm out trolling. Most of the time, run them naked on that 10 to 12 pound fluorocarbon leader. But every once in a while at the bigger impoundments, I'm gonna throw on a 6-inch blade. It could be one of my fisheyes, could be a sling blade, whatever. I like these slim profile blades, control them a little faster. They work very well. And when you hook a fish, they put very little drag into the rig. Traditional herring dodgers, they have a significant amount of drag, and whenever you hook a fish, the dodger's still working, and you know, they kind of deaden the fight of the fish. So anyway, whatever brand you choose, mine, Sling Blades from Max Lure, whatever, I'd go with a slim profile 6-inch blade when I was out trolling spoons for trout or kings and I wanted to use a dodger. Anyway, that's all I got to say for now. I want to thank the Anderson family for all the support, and thank you for that awesome video you shot. And I will catch all you guys here next time on YouTube. If you're looking for lures, go on over to the Fish Hunt Shoot Productions store. Please hit that subscribe button down there if you haven't hit it. And hit that bell too, and that way you'll get a notification every time I'm on here talking fishing. We just went over a major milestone, guys. We have 3 million views on the channel. I mean, man, I was hoping for 3 views when I first started shooting videos. So I'm pretty stoked about that number. It's been a long road, and I couldn't have done it without all you guys. So thank you very much. Thank you for all the support, and I will catch you next time right here on YouTube. I'm feeling some raindrops. I think I'm going inside. Anyway, I'll see you out in the water. I'm Kel Kellogg. You have a great day.